Cantor Audio presents The Dogs Were Rescued, and So Was I, by Teresa J. Rhyne, narrated by Carrington MacDuffie. I hold that the more helpless a creature, the more entitled it is to protection by man from the cruelty of man. Mahatma Gandhi. Chapter 1. Seeing Red. My dog Seamus and I were sitting in the backyard of a friend's home, the same home where I'd celebrated the end of my cancer treatments in a survivor-themed party, when I saw Red. It was a bright, clear fall day in 2011. As Seamus wiggled in my lap, the sun illuminated a pool of blood deep in his eye. I immediately denied what I was seeing, unable to believe there could be another health issue. Not now. This was a shadow, a reflection of my fuchsia sweater, an illusion. This was anything but what I knew it was. If I hadn't been so shocked, I would have seen the irony in finding that spot in his eye just then. We were posing for the author photo for my memoir about how he, my beagle, my love, my hilarious, spirited guide to life, had survived his own cancer and given me the strength and courage to survive mine. As soon as the photo shoot was over, and what was a familiar routine for me, I scheduled a vet appointment. The vet just as quickly sent us to a specialist. I was back in a sterile white room with my dog, trusting and fearless, standing on a metal table. The initial evaluation was done by an intern. He was polite, quiet, and appeared to be thorough in his exam, but he said very little to me. Seamus stayed calm on the table, as he always did, glancing my way only occasionally. When the exam was over, Seamus howled. "He wants a cookie," I said. "He's well trained to know he gets a treat when the exam is over, preferably a green dog bone if you have one." The intern smiled. "Poor guy. I'll get him a treat, but I don't know about green. I'll bring it back when the doctor comes in." Several minutes later, the intern, the doctor, and a tech came in the room, an entire foreboding team. The intern handed Seamus a cookie. It wasn't green, but Seamus merrily took it and howled for more. The intern laughed and petted Seamus's head. The doctor promised he'd give him more later. Other than that, though, the doctor was all business, and maybe that should have been a clue, too. Seamus had first been diagnosed with cancer a year after I adopted him. He was only 2, maybe 3 years old at the time. He spent a year in treatment, 2 surgeries, many months of chemotherapy, and then another year and a half of follow-ups and blood tests before he was deemed cancer-free and released from treatment. 6 months after that, I was diagnosed with triple-negative breast cancer and spent nearly a year in treatment myself. I was still going for semi-annual oncology checkups, so it's not like I was new to doctors and devastating diagnoses. You'd think I'd get used to this. "I don't like this," he said, peering with the ophthalmoscope, its pinpoint light shining in Seamus's left eye. "Did you see this?" And here he switched into the medical jargon that some medical personnel use so easily without any thought that the patient, or in this case the patient's guardian, cannot understand it and therefore would only be frightened by it. "I did see that," the intern said, glancing quickly in my direction and away again. "Of course there's something to see. It's why I brought him in." I tried to stay calm, but the doctor's approach was not helping. "Yeah, that's not good at all. I don't like what I'm seeing," he said to no one in particular, as he was still looking into Seamus's eye. I wanted to smack him. "I'm sitting right here. Hold your editorial until you are ready to talk to me." But I have a history of wanting to lash out at doctors. I'd felt that way about Seamus's first oncologist, I not so fondly referred to her as Dr. Sorority Bitch, and the oncologist I did chemo with, Dr. B, no explanation needed, I trust, though clearly I could use some creativity in my anger. The intern switched the exam room lights back on. Finally, the doctor turned to me. "This isn't good. What I see is most likely, I'm almost certain, a melanoma." I had long ago noticed, in my vast experience with cancer, that very few people, medical personnel included, actually say the C word. "Cancer?" I said.
"I'm afraid so."
"Shit, I am so sick of cancer. How bad is it? This cannot be happening. How bad is it? Cannot be happening. Not again. How bad is it? I stayed quiet, stroking Seamus's head while I steadied myself. Can you give him that other cookie now? And maybe one for me? The doctor pulled a dog biscuit from the pocket of his lab coat and fed it to Seamus, who gladly ate it in only a few quick bites and then howled, wagging his tail. He's a really cute dog, the doctor said. He is, and he has already survived cancer once, a mast cell tumor. He's been through 2 surgeries and months of chemotherapy. While one hand held Seamus, my other was clenched in a fist at my side. Is this related to that cancer? A recurrence now, 7 years later? The doctor's eyebrows shot up, but he was quick to recover. No, not related. This is a different cancer altogether. He's just not very lucky. Luck? It was only luck, or more to the point, bad luck, that determined who got cancer? I guess I'm not very lucky either. I'm also a cancer survivor. Now the doctor's surprise stayed on his face. Wow, that's a lot of cancer in one house. Do you live near a nuclear reactor or something? I was no amateur at hearing a cancer diagnosis. I had experienced it done both better and worse than this. I couldn't tell if he thought he was making a joke, but whether he was or not, it was an entirely inappropriate comment. Now we'd swung from luck to where we live maybe being the cause of cancer. Time to bring the doc's focus back to where it should be, to what next? So where do we go from here? What's the treatment? Do you know for certain it is cancer? He gave a long explanation, with the usual amount of confusing and frightening medical terms. It came down to surgery. The doctor was 99% certain there was a melanoma on Seamus's eye. Whatever it was, it had to be removed. Chemo and radiation were not options for this cancer. They could remove the eye and likely be done with it, or they could try shaving the tumor off and saving the eye, but if it grew back, they'd have to remove the eye then. Chances were it would grow back. The only issue would be how long it took. The longer it took, of course, the longer he'd keep the eye. Could be weeks, could be months, could be years. Seamus was 9, maybe 10 years old then. Since I'd adopted him from a shelter, I was uncertain of his actual age. But still, at 9 or 10, he could live 4, 5 years longer, maybe more. Trying to save the eye seemed the right thing to do. If he were older, maybe I'd worry more about the possibility of 2 surgeries and the toll that would take. But he'd been such a trooper during all he'd been through that I had great faith in his recovery abilities. Plus, I'd become accustomed to beating the cancer odds, maybe even inexplicably cocky about it. I want to try to save his eye, I said.
That's what I'd do, too.
The doctor moved toward the door.
We'll get you an estimate of the cost and schedule the surgery.
We scheduled the surgery for December. I considered waiting until January, because December is when all bad things seem to happen in my life. My entire family has a bad history with the time between Thanksgiving and Christmas. Accidents, deaths, cancer diagnoses. Note the plural on all of those events. I dread the entire holiday season, but particularly the month of December. And now, another reason to despise it. But I didn't want to just leave cancer hanging around in the poor dog's eye, any more than I had wanted to leave it hanging out in my right breast when I was diagnosed in December 2008. Seamus, in his usual style, and as I had counted on, recovered from this surgery quickly. But he still needed care, bandages changed, pain medication, and eye drops. So I resumed our old routine. I was his caretaker, working from home, and he was his rascally self, using his diabolical cuteness and now his new swashbuckling eye patch to work me over for more treats. And for those days, at home with Seamus, the doctor's words ate at my brain.
Do you live near a nuclear reactor or something?
We didn't, of course. Does anybody anymore? I lived in a townhome, up on a ridge in Riverside, a suburb of Southern California, usually described as halfway between Los Angeles and Palm Springs. I lived there with Seamus and Chris, the beagle and human loves of my life. There was no nuclear reactor. But 3 cancers in one household over 7 years was a lot of cancer. Too much cancer. Was I doing something wrong? And of course, I'd tied my own cancer recovery so closely to Seamus's, it was difficult not to think I might have a recurrence too.
"The dog lived and so will I," had been my mantra as I went through a breast lumpectomy, 3 months of chemotherapy, and 36 rounds of radiation. "The dog lived" was the name of my blog, and eventually, "The dog lived and so will I" was the name of the memoir I'd written. And now, the dog had cancer again. It was impossible not to feel, "and so will I." Maybe I had done everything wrong. With Seamus's original cancer, and again with my own, I never spent a lot of time wondering why the cancer had occurred. I didn't spend time attaching blame or wondering why me. But now it was getting hard to avoid the thought that maybe there was a reason this was happening to us. What was I doing wrong? Why was this happening? When I had finished my cancer treatments, I quickly resumed my old lifestyle. I had not had the great epiphany one hears many cancer patients have. I kept waiting for the urge to run marathons, rescue orphans, or quit my job and travel the world. But I was waiting while reading magazines, sipping a martini, and feasting on fried calamari. And my cancer had been triple negative, which means not responsive to hormones, so the doctors had not given me any dietary restrictions. Naturally, I used that as an excuse for many celebratory meals of dubious nutritional value. Now, though, with Seamus on the couch next to me, curled up and sleeping soundly, his eye patch clearly visible, the bottles of pain medication and antibiotics lined up on the kitchen counter, and with me only a few months away from my own oncology visit, I knew I had to do something. I had to change. I vowed, for Seamus, for me, for our household, that I'd find a way to do better. I'd find a way to fight for us all. Chapter 2. This is personal. Since I had a few days at home with Seamus while he recovered, and because I rely on reading like I rely on coffee, I could not live without either of them, I began to read all that I could find on fighting cancer. I read like my life and my dogs depended on it. Though I wanted to avoid this answer, very quickly it became obvious that diet and exercise were essential foot soldiers in the assault on cancer I was about to launch. I'd never been good at either of these things. If I didn't have Seamus, I'd never exercise at all. I'd celebrated oncology checkups at the cheese store of Beverly Hills. I considered potato chips and Chardonnay a meal, and a darn fine one. Comfort food was macaroni and cheese, fettuccine Alfredo, or, of course, fast food. Cheeseburgers and fries, burritos, nachos, all of it. I'd never been one of those girls who ate small, dainty foods in tiny, cute portions. The more carbs, cream, and fat, the better, as far as I was concerned. And as I'm nearly 6 feet tall, I'd always told myself it was okay that I ate like a guy. That guy may have been a linebacker, but whatever. I loved heavy, processed, fatty food. I wasn't that way as a child, though. As a kid, my favorite food was apples. That's even what I gave up for Lent at the height of my Catholic years, and nobody accused me of trying to make it easy on myself. I wasn't much of a meat eater, didn't like candy, desserts, kids' breakfast cereals, or Thanksgiving dinner, except the mashed potatoes and the cranberry jelly. I loved fruits, salads, and nuts. Somewhere along the line, that changed, and I couldn't even recall when, let alone why. By high school, I was living off fast food. Bacon cheeseburgers, meat and cheese burritos slathered in sour cream, chili cheese dogs and French fries were constants in my life. That didn't change in college, though pizza and potato chips joined the lineup. Law school did not improve my diet, unless one considered a tuna melt at the greasy diner down the street an improvement. It wasn't, and still, there were the fries. Until I hit my 40s, my metabolism kept up with all of this just fine, so I'd never been on a diet of any kind either. I simply never paid attention to what I ate. And then along came Chris. Chris had gone through Seamus's and my cancers every step of the way, and he is a wonderful cook who loves food, all kinds of food. So when he moved in with me and began doing the cooking, my tastes shifted again to more of what he liked and prepared. He is a man who loves steak, hamburgers, a pastrami sandwich, hearty omelets, and anything with bacon. And so I began to eat red meat. Steak slathered with blue cheese was a signature dish of Chris's that I favored. He also made a phenomenal paella that became our traditional Mus Chris meal, the weekend before the dreaded Christmas. I had my limits, though. I did not eat veal, venison, duck, lamb, or, as Chris claimed was my standard, any cute animals. Fine. Diet is an obvious and important factor in this battle we didn't ask for. My diet could certainly improve, despite my years of denial. So it was time I paid attention to that. Fine. And I'd pay attention to Seamus's diet, too. Though the surgery had been successful and Seamus recovered quickly, we'd been told the chances were high that the tumor would come back. It was just a matter of time. In the meantime, we administered eye drops twice a day. Naturally, I started our nutritional boot camp with changes to Seamus's diet. This seemed both easier and more immediate. I was right about the immediacy, less so about the simplicity. There was, it seemed, a prescribed cancer-fighting diet for dogs. Many articles, books, and websites sang the virtues of certain foods as cancer-fighting and best for dogs all around. My problem was that they were gross. There was a lot of animal organs, bones, and raw meats involved. It was hard to imagine doing this. I ate meat, sure, but I preferred not to think of it as ever having been alive. Organs were just not something I wanted to touch. If it would help Seamus, I'd do it, but I hoped to find a better answer. I found several dog food brands that sounded promising. But now the problem was that they were raw foods, packaged and shipped frozen, so they were very expensive, as one might imagine shipping organs would be. And I didn't have a very large freezer, not like one of those in which you'd store, say, a year's worth of venison you'd hunted and killed yourself. Eventually, I found a food that seemed perfect. Human-grade, grain-free, whole foods. The ingredients were much the same as the abhorrent diet I'd prefer not to make myself, and because the food was dehydrated, I could afford to have it shipped. Now, where to find it? I checked the list of suppliers, but neither had it on their own websites. I emailed both companies, and that evening had a response from a man named River. No, not an old man. River was poetically effusive about holistic methods for fighting cancer and proudly stated homeopathy had been curing cancer since the 1600s. He proclaimed that every item his shop sold was toxin-free, safe for the environment, and my animal companion. He also mentioned he spent his time caring for his farm, saving animals, and finding grace. So he hadn't updated his site, but he was sure he could get me what I needed. I was new to this concept of clean living and caring about the environment, so the cynic in me could only think, oh, forget the dog food. Please do tell me where one searches for grace. Or, given that his name was River, perhaps Grace was his daughter or his wife, in which case I hoped he found her, and Harmony, who no doubt lived on the sanctuary too. It was tempting to run off on one of the many tangents such an email offered a mind like mine, but I opted to stay with the dog food aspect. I emailed back to order the particular formula I wanted. I got this response. Are you putting Seamus on a barf diet? Peace, River. A what diet? And no, definitely not. Whatever that was, Seamus would not be eating it. That was not a river I was going down, River. A winding, drifty, unfocused, but enthusiastic 10 emails later, I knew that a barf diet meant a biologically appropriate raw food diet. I had ordered 2 4-pound boxes of the Honest Kitchen dehydrated food, and River had effused about things like alternating proteins and adding colostrums and probiotics, because, as he said, he was a healer and messenger, and my path is to end all the needless suffering that occurs. To have the knowledge I have and not share it seems selfish, especially when it makes such a huge difference and can cure cancer, etc. I particularly loved the cure cancer, etc. You know, all those things like curing cancer? He did that, too. But I did love his passion. I could use some of that. Best to just start with the dehydrated food, though, especially since bottled passion was not listed on his website. On second thought, perhaps that was a different website entirely. When the boxes arrived, shipped from his green corner sanctuary on the East Coast all the way across the country to me in California, I could not help but laugh. My research had not been thorough, and his non-toxic-to-earth statement was not quite accurate. The product was manufactured in San Diego, California, about 60 miles southwest of me. The Honest Kitchen had shipped 8 pounds of dehydrated food to the East Coast so he could turn around and ship it back to the West Coast. I didn't know a lot about carbon footprints, but I was pretty sure I had some carbon karma points to make up. I was also sure that, sadly, it did not make economic or carbon sense to do further business with my new river friend when I could simply order directly from the company 60 miles away. It wouldn't have been my style to just figure that out in the first place. Seamus loved the food. Well, Seamus loved all food, so that was not a surprise, but he did seem pretty excited about this new feast. The hardest part for him, as it must be for any self-respecting beagle, was waiting the 5 minutes it took for the food to reconstitute after warm water was added. He howled and cursed at me for every second of the 5 minutes. Chris and I had long ago given Seamus a human voice that was part Irish brogue, part Bill Murray's Carl Spackler character in Caddyshack. Consequently, he howled, "Fuck!" a lot. Spurred on once again by a beagle's battle with cancer, I launched my own healthier lifestyle as well. I cut out fast food and was determined to limit glasses of wine throughout the week. Notice my specificity. I should note here that Chris owns an online wine store that also has a tasting room retail location in Riverside, which kept him working long hours, eating fast food without me, and frequently bringing home his wine wares for us both to sample. Hey, it was a job requirement. And I walked Seamus more. The walking would be good for Seamus and me, I told myself. But then I also told myself, 5 more minutes, every time the alarm went off following my repeated hits on the snooze button. I did get up and walk him, though, a few times. On one of those walks, impressed by my 3 consecutive days of progress, I decided there was something more I could do. I would try a different kind of exercise. Fresh air does strange things to me. I hate participating in sports, and gyms make me crazy. All that sweat and locker rooms harkening back to junior high are just not my thing. Well, who am I kidding? Exercise is not my thing. But yoga, I imagined, would not be sweaty and would not be a competition. It would, I hoped, be relaxing. I needed exercise, and stress relief couldn't be a bad thing. Yoga seemed like a wise choice, shocked as everyone was to whom I mentioned it. As it turned out, I shocked myself. I liked yoga, and the classes were not filled with dreadlocked hippies. We don't actually have those in Riverside. Zen-like, lithe, blonde women lifting their 80-pound bodies into the air, balanced only on slender wrists with their legs wrapped around their ears. Those were only the instructors. Or men with hair longer than mine, and silkier, bastards. No, these were average folks, who, like me, were tired of being puffy, bloated, and, well, ravaged by disease. But I did sweat. Man, did I sweat. And while I liked yoga, the feeling did not appear to be mutual. One Saturday morning, as the instructor demonstrated a particularly impossible and unnatural-looking pose, I burst out laughing. Hey, at least I was getting the stress of relief down. The instructor looked my way, as did the rest of the class. A yoga faux pas. I'm sorry, I'm just pretty sure my body can't do that. I don't think I've ever been that flexible in my life. No, he agreed. You'll have to work on your flexibility. You may want to look at one of our stretching classes. Or a different yoga studio. I struggled through, chastened, and rigid in oh so many ways. Afterward, I overheard a woman who had to be at least 20 years older than me explaining to the instructor that she really wanted to work on her flexibility. She wanted to know about the stretching classes, too. I mean, she said, I'm worse than her. She pointed to me, the new standard for inflexibility. My yoga hobby was starting to look short-lived. On top of the embarrassment of my performance, I was terrible at sticking to a schedule and frequently missed classes. Yoga once a week was great, but it was hardly going to stave off cancer. To increase my chances of more regular sessions, I hired one of the yoga instructors, tall, thin, impossibly elastic, but very amiable Lauren, to teach private classes at my office, and I roped a few friends into joining me. If yoga came directly to me, I could not hide, and my friends were not likely to be much more flexible than I was, when it came to yoga, I mean. Wednesday nights and Saturday mornings found my law office reception area covered in yoga mats, with middle-aged women trying to warrior pose our way through to corpse pose, the only one we were any good at. One friend's inability to achieve happy baby pose, lying on your back, grabbing the soles of your feet with both hands, knees toward your face, caused us to dub the pose Angry Baby instead, and Lauren's insistence that we hold warrior pose far longer than any of us felt necessary or attainable caused us to dub her Yoga Bitch. She was zen enough to accept and wear the title proudly. On Saturday mornings, I walked Seamus and then brought him with me to the office. He moved from person to person, checking our poses and wondering if we happened to have brought any food with us. By the end of the session, he could be found seated in Yoga Bitch's lap, enjoying a belly rub and oblivious to my pain. I think Lauren snuck him treats, so at least he wouldn't think of her as Yoga Bitch. He thought of her as Snack Bitch. On my little dog and I marched in our war against cancer. Chris looked on, mostly encouraging and definitely amused, but not participating in the fight himself. He's 12 years younger than me, and thus perhaps not as ready to look at his own immortality. But springtime saw us launch new counterattacks, and I surprised myself as much as I did Chris. Chapter 3. Honey and Anchovies. My continuing research led me to a holistic supplement study for canine cancer that was sponsored by the National Canine Cancer Foundation. I immediately enrolled Seamus, and he was accepted into the group of currently fighting cancer dogs. He took the supplements twice a day, and we restricted his treats to one or two a day. Instead of the snacks he loved, we gave him apple slices or celery or broccoli, which were becoming my snacks too. As a consequence, there were chewed remains of spit-up greens dotting our kitchen floor regularly, some of them left by Seamus. I had even lost a few pounds and was only inches away from touching my toes in yoga class. I continued my search for more ways to wage war on cancer myself as well. Although in my pre-cancer life I would have avoided both a women's conference and a health conference, I now willingly attended a women's health conference at a local hospital not far from where I had undergone my chemotherapy treatments. My search for weapons was going to be thorough, if a tad imprecise. In the late morning, I found I had two choices for the breakout session. One featured none other than the icicle of a woman who'd been in charge, albeit only on paper, of my chemotherapy, Dr. B herself, talking about who knows what, but I was certain I didn't want to hear it and didn't want to see her. By default, I headed to the other session. I walked into the conference room and saw that the presentation would be by Juliana Hever, the author of The Complete Idiot's Guide to Plant-Based Nutrition. I seemed to fit the target market, as I'd never even heard the term plant-based diet. I forced myself to keep an open mind. I'd told myself that I was going to explore all options for Seamus and me to fight our cancers, and a plant-based diet was certainly an option, just not one I thought I was capable of. I was early, so I approached the table in the back of the room where books were stacked. I picked up the Idiot's Guide and began to flip pages.
"Hi, thanks for being here."
I looked up and saw what can only be described as a glowing woman. Her skin shone, her hair shone, massively thick and dark, falling just below her shoulders. Her eyes twinkled and her teeth gleamed from her, right from her shining smile. I don't think I'd ever seen anyone exude health like this woman did. Of course, I'd been spending a lot of time in oncology wards, so what did I know? "Hi." I put the book down and extended my hand. "You must be the speaker?" She shook my hand.
"I am. I'm Juliana Hever. I'm so glad you're here."
"I'll admit I know nothing about this. I am the complete idiot. But I'm also a cancer survivor, so I feel like I need to do something more." We spoke for 10 minutes. She was all sunshine and rainbows, and I was all clouds of doubt and rainstorms. Give up cheese? But man, I wanted to be like this woman. That doesn't happen to me a lot. So I pushed on. I told her about Seamus, our book coming out, and my search to stave off cancer taking over our lives. She extolled the virtues of plants and mentioned the various studies that had been done, referring me to the documentary Forks Over Knives. She swore the plant-based lifestyle was easy. I was feeling, what was that feeling? An unfamiliar, tingling, sort of inspired. I was feeling inspired, that was it. But wait, what about wine and coffee, or as I think of them, water and air, I said. She laughed.
Both are plant-based. You're good. Everything in moderation, but that goes for any diet.
Define moderation. No, never mind. Don't.
I bought her book and took a seat in the second row. I was 2 days away from my oncology checkup. What did I have to lose? When Chris got home that night, I pounced.
I'm going to try a plant-based diet.
A what?
Plant-based diet. Just food that comes from plants, not animals.
So, vegan?
I paused.
Huh?
I don't think so. No, nobody said anything about vegan.
But isn't that vegan? No animal products?
Maybe. I grabbed the book and handed it to him.
No, it doesn't say that. Vegan sounds way too intimidating.
Beans, vegetables, lentils, tofu. What part of this does not sound vegan to you?
He said, flipping pages.
The cover of the book? The presentation I listened to today?
He handed the book back to me.
You know this means no cheese, right? I'd already had to scrape the cheese off my vegetarian pasta at lunch, so yes, I knew that.
I said I was going to try healthier lifestyle choices to figure out what works. I figure if I do this, go cold tofu, and totally hate it, I can gradually add things back in and figure out the best balance. Maybe I go back to eating cheese or fish or eggs, who knows? But it makes more sense to me to cut it all out and see how I like it. See how my body responds.
Because that's harder, so of course that makes more sense to you.
It's more logical.
We both laughed. My greatest strength was logic, but overdone, I've been told it becomes a point of weakness. I am generally more logical than emotional, and this is sometimes a problem, for others. I thought my logic here was sound. If I tried vegetarian, or as I'd been doing, just eating healthier, I'd still find a way to melt cheese on everything and pile on the cream, as I'd been doing for months. I'd be eating broccoli, but it would be dipped in ranch dressing, just as my salad would be swimming in blue cheese. This way, I at least had a guide, a nutritionist I could talk to. Juliana, it turned out, was infinitely accessible through social media, and some solid evidence that this was an appropriate diet for fighting cancer.
I'm shocked and worried. Yoga and now this. You're still going to shave your legs, right?
Chris said. Yes, I'm just going to use an artichoke.
What?
Totally kidding. But here's the good news. I haven't completely lost my mind. Wine is plant-based.
Oh, thank God.
He moved toward the wine refrigerator.
I'm pouring the plants now.
A day and a half later, having eaten nothing but surprisingly delicious plants, Juliana's easy beans and quinoa with onion, garlic, corn, and cilantro, kale and broccoli salad, and a breakfast of almond butter on whole wheat toast with my old friend, a red apple, and drinking a lot of water, I felt the effects. Not only did I have more energy, but I'd also lost 2 pounds, and I wasn't hungry. This was a great start. Other than having to go to the restroom 4 times during the night, cleansing anyone, I slept soundly. That normally did not happen in the nights preceding my oncology checkups. I was 3 years out from my cancer diagnosis by this point. I'd almost stopped even thinking of myself as a cancer patient, except in the 24 hours or so preceding a doctor's visit. It is hard not to think of oneself as a cancer patient when oncology appointment is on the calendar. Every 6 months, I'd been going for these checkups, and I'd always kept my date with NED, no evidence of disease. My anxiety decreased each time. Then I was hit with Seamus's new diagnosis. It had only been 4 months since his surgery and our gradual diet and exercise changes. That probably wasn't enough to discourage any cancer cells in my body thinking about making a comeback. Or maybe I was fooling myself and they'd long ago started the reunion, probably back when Seamus's diagnosis came. This would be a great time for my logic to kick in. But it wasn't happening. In my mind, our destinies were locked. The feeling that what happened to Seamus would happen to me was not logical, but when it came to dogs, and Seamus in particular, well, that's where logic failed me. And there really is no logic to cancer anyway. Making matters more difficult, Chris would not be accompanying me to my appointment. When I was in treatment, he'd gone with me to every appointment, even my blood tests, and he'd humored and cared for me through it all. Since he'd opened Chris Kern's Forgotten Grapes online wine shop, and I was years out from my diagnosis, I began going myself. I much preferred his company, of course, but he had a business to run, and I wanted him to succeed. He deserved it. Besides, there'd be no cheese shop visit for us this time. I flipped magazine pages in the waiting room and tried not to look at the other patients. When I weighed in with the nurse, the scale showed a loss of 4 pounds. I wanted to boast about my 72-hour-long plant-based diet, but in addition to that sounding nuts, I thought I might be answered with, "Weight loss is a sign of cancer," which is actually even more nuts. But one is entitled to such thoughts during an oncology checkup. I'd had crazier thoughts. A blood pressure check, an exam, and a blood test later, the physician's assistant said, "That's it, you're all clear." I sat up straighter in my paper towel dress. "That's it?" "That's it. You can get dressed now," she said, closing my file. "Except one other thing." I knew it. I only had 6 months to live, maybe less, or just a general, "There's cancer everywhere" statement, because that happens from a blood test. "One other thing?" "We'll move you to annual checkups now. You'll still have your mammogram in October, and then your checkup with us in April, so technically someone's checking on you every 6 months still, but you don't have to see us every 6 months."
Huh. Okay, well, that would be good, right? Fewer oncology appointments can't be a bad thing, and I'd found the lump myself the first time, so I certainly know what I'm looking for. Plus, now I had plant-based superpowers on my side. Back at home, I celebrated by cuddling with Seamus, making a mango avocado and black bean salad with lime juice, olive oil, and cilantro dressing, and going online to join Farm Fresh to You, a community-supported agriculture group that would deliver local farm fresh produce to my door every other week. I was feeling good and becoming a believer, perhaps even an evangelist. My cancer wasn't back. We were winning the war. All hail kale! Emboldened, I continued to arm us for battle. Though there was a misfire. Inevitable, I suppose. For Seamus, an important part of my troops, I bought a $30, 100-page holistic canine cancer-fighting book online that seemed to be everything I was looking for, and it was written by a doctor. When the book arrived, though, I soon noted that nowhere did it say what kind of doctor the author was. Technically, as I have a Juris Doctor agree, I am a doctor, too. Please don't ever take medical advice from me. Blood makes me pass out, as does the word stitches. Hang on while I come to again. And I've had no medical training whatsoever, except as a patient. As I read the book, I began to question, as the author intended, not just the proper feeding of a domesticated dog, but also much of the traditional gospel of pet care. Could neutering dogs really increase the risk of cancer? Seamus was already neutered when I got him, so it hadn't been my choice. Was adding apple cider vinegar to his drinking water really going to fight off fleas and cancer? Win-win. But then the author started to lose me. He was adamantly against chemotherapy treatments for dogs or for anyone. This seemed too far outside the norm for me, especially since chemotherapy had been the only treatment available to both Seamus and me following our respective cancer surgeries. When I read his muscle testing procedure for determining areas of health concern, he completely lost me. It seemed to be a version of the Ouija board where, instead of passing hands over an alphabet on a board to receive messages from a spirit, one passed their hands over a dog and asked certain true or false questions. "My name is Tippy St. Clair," would be a warm-up question to make sure I had the technique down. And if I did, the circle I'd make with my index finger and thumb would easily break when I passed my other index finger through the point where the fingers touched, since this was a false statement. Or my middle finger would rise, something like that. I had wasted $30, $30 I'd never get back, and frankly, I didn't deserve to. I hadn't done my homework once again. Summer arrived. Our battle with cancer looked less like a war and more like a truce. Despite my misfiring, Seamus was thriving. He looked lean and muscular, and he was clearly enjoying his new food, supplements, and exercise. Chris was still the one primarily responsible for taking Seamus on the serious walks, but I like to think Seamus enjoyed the more casual walks with me, sniffing anything and everything as he pleased. And I was clearly thriving on my plant-based diet. In just over 3 months, I'd lost 30 pounds. It had not even been difficult. Sure, occasionally I looked longingly at what Chris was eating, and occasionally I accused him of eating my old favorites,
steak and blue cheese, just to tease me, but mostly the effects of my diet were so instantaneous and rewarding, I stuck to it with relative ease. I enjoyed the foods I was eating. I enjoyed preparing my meals. In the past, I'd been a decent cook, as long as I was following a recipe, but it wasn't something I was passionate about, and I was never one of those people who could look in the cupboard or refrigerator and say, "Oh yes, I have red pepper, dill pickles, and beef. Therefore, I'll make my delicious pepper dill steak casserole gourmet meal." See, I couldn't even cook properly with words. Seriously, who would eat that? I didn't have any understanding of what flavors went with what, or how, when, or why meats should be prepared, and I never liked looking at raw meat, let alone handling it. I just figured the kitchen wasn't my fort. I left that to Chris. Now, though, I was enjoying the kitchen. I bought a separate cutting board, no meat, for my veggies, and I learned about quinoa, lentils, hemp, and the miracle of kale. I began to follow vegans on Twitter and Facebook, all of whom regularly shared delicious-sounding recipes. I was constantly printing off new recipes, with apologies to the environment, and Pinterest, which clearly I needed to join. I prepared lemony quinoa with pine nuts and spinach, gingered quinoa with dates and watercress, fig and blue cheese pita sandwiches, a rainbow salad of kale, cabbage, oranges, red onion, bell pepper, and sunflower seeds in a Dijon mustard and orange juice dressing, a curried quinoa wrap with avocado citrus slaw, and every morning a delicious, energizing kale or other leafy green smoothie. Mix up pineapple, mango, coconut water, kale, and chia seeds, and it was as if I were on a tropical vacation. Frozen bananas, almond butter, almond milk, and cinnamon whipped together was far more like a milkshake than the healthy drink it was. And frozen cherries, cabbage, and cinnamon blended with coconut water? 7-Eleven could sell it as a Slurpee. I convinced a group of plant-curious friends to get together on Sundays and prepare various dishes that we could divide up and take with us for lunches at work over the next few days, in addition to enjoying one fabulous, healthy, energizing dinner together. And, most importantly, Chris joined me for many of the meals. Occasionally, he'd still insist on a chicken breast next to my quinoa creation, or he'd throw a steak on top of my kale concoction, but he was eating far better than I think he realized. I realized, though, exactly what was happening to my body. My energy was up. I was sleeping through the night. And, as I told anybody who listened, willingly or not, everything chemo had done to my body, the plant-based diet reversed, except for the part about killing off the cancer cells. That part was sticking. I could have starred in any one of the food and health documentaries I'd been watching, the same documentaries that now had me thinking about the animals in our food system in a way I never had before. I still made mistakes, like forgetting that honey was an animal product. I had to research that one. Was there actually a health problem with eating honey? Turned out, opinions vary. Not everyone thinks an insect is an animal, for one. But there is the theory that honey is an animal protein that contains something distastefully, on purpose I assume, known as animal ferments, and therefore is not good for human health. I also learned that bees make honey by continually eating and regurgitating it. Lovely! And then there was the vegan approach. The production and harvesting of honey involves enslaving and exploiting the bees, which are removed from their natural environment and can be harmed in the harvest process. Therefore, if one is vegan, one does not eat honey. Eating honey is apparently the gateway to the slippery slope away from a true vegan ethic. A bee's pain is okay, therefore maybe a fish's is too, and then perhaps a quail, a rabbit, a pig. The difference between the plant-based diet I'd been following and a vegan lifestyle began to crystallize. A plant-based diet was about me. A vegan lifestyle was about the animals. I tucked that thought away in the back of my mind, and I tucked the honey away in the back of the pantry. Then I went to a wine dinner at Chris's wine shop. The winemaker from one of our favorite Paso Robles wineries, DuBost Winery, was there to share and discuss her wine while her husband grilled and served wild game he'd shot and prepared himself. We loved Kate and Kurt and their wines, so there was no way I was missing this event, even with the thought of grilled boar to discourage me. Chris resolved my dilemma when he asked Kurt to grill some additional vegetables for me. The salad course was delicious, and while the others enjoyed the grilled oysters and Kate's Sauvignon Blanc, I nibbled on bread in a delicious garlicky olive oil dip. And then I had more bread, and then more, and perhaps some wine. Chris stopped by my table to see how I was faring.
"I can't believe you aren't eating oysters. You love oysters," he said.
"They're an animal. I'm sticking to this."
"I don't think they even feel pain. Aren't they lacking a central nervous system?"
"Well, that's not really the point."
"Or true, I don't think.
Anyway, I'm fine. Besides, this bread and olive oil is delicious."
"So you'll eat anchovies but not oysters?"
I dropped my yummy soaked bread. "Anchovies? What?" I vaguely recalled Kate mentioning anchovy something when she discussed the menu. I had not thought anchovy equaled animal, nor had I thought that salty, savory taste in my dipping sauce was anchovy. Chris pointed to the nearly empty saucer in front of me.
"May as well eat the oysters at this point."
I was crestfallen. I'd done so well. First honey, now anchovies. Who knew? Well, of course, anyone who thinks about what they're eating before they stick it in their mouths would know. I pushed the bread plate away, though part of me wondered how much empathy I could really muster for an anchovy. It was a learning process, and I had a lifetime of eating habits to get over, but I was determined to do it. I was vain enough to be inspired by the weight loss, but smart enough to know my physical well-being had greatly improved, so I was sticking to the plant-based diet, stumble though I may. I was just going to have to think things through a bit more. Already it took me twice as long to grocery shop than it ever had before. I started shopping at Trader Joe's and Sprouts, which were farther away from me, and fervently hoped for a Whole Foods or Gelson's to magically appear in my city. I visited a local farm stand as frequently as I could and drove downtown on Saturday mornings for the farmer's market. In the stores, I had to read ingredient lists diligently. They sneak milk, eggs, and cheese into just about everything. And why is there honey in wheat bread? Which meant a constant on and off with my reading glasses, which I viewed as a mocking symbol of my middle-agedness. I was also learning about ingredients I'd never heard of before. Where does one find nutritional yeast? Is it with bread yeast? No, it's with the vitamins and protein powder. There is such a thing as dairy-free yogurt? Yes, yes, there is. It's made from nut milks. Tempeh? Seitan? Yep, over near the tofu, which is ironically over near the refrigerated dairy section. Chia seeds, flaxseed, hemp? Bags of it, and again, over near the vitamins and supplements. And now, my favorite aisles were the bulk food aisles. Raw cashews, walnuts, grains, quinoa galore, all to my heart's content. And fresh ground almond butter. And wait, macadamia nut butter? Heaven! I'd also discovered the joys and many uses of coconut oil, which I now cooked with and also used as a moisturizer and makeup remover. On the other hand, there were entire rows and sections at the grocery store that no longer applied to me. I could sail past all the processed foods and the dairy and meat departments, in other words, 3/4 of the grocery store. The shopping part I was getting down pat. I'd have to work on eating out. But I'd get the hang of this sooner or later. I'd watched Forks Over Knives, the documentary Juliana had recommended, and I was more determined than ever, both for my health and for the animals. Buoyed by my new lifestyle, inspired by my ability to change, and with Seamus doing well, I had another life-changing idea around midsummer. I shared it with Chris in the hot tub one evening, perhaps surprising myself as much as him. "I'm thinking of going to India."
"Huh?"
Fair enough response. Chris and I both loved to travel, and we'd both traveled a fair amount. There was a long and ever-expanding list of places we wanted to visit, but India was not yet on it. Given that some of my least favorite past travel experiences were in Asia, it's understandable that India might catch him off guard. "I can explain."
"Please do."
One of the breast cancer blogs I follow is written by a young woman who, post-breast cancer, did a sort of trip around the world by volunteering. She went to something like 4 countries on 3 continents, volunteering in orphanages and whatnot, as a way to refocus her post-treatment life.
"That is not explaining India at all. In fact, the mention of orphanages just makes me think you have a high fever, and none of this can or should be explained. Though I do love your clarity on the stranger you met on the internet who maybe sorta did, you know, stuff," Chris said.
"Dang, I hate it when he makes sense.
That was perhaps not my best, most impassioned statement. I was new at this. I was not the kind of person who travels the globe doing volunteer work and living in youth hostels, and certainly not anywhere near an orphanage. I want to be that person. I just also want my blow dryer, plenty of quiet, relaxing downtime, room service, and cute outfits, and no children around. But I pressed on. So this young woman, Terry, she's formed a nonprofit called A Fresh Chapter, and she's putting together a group of 12 cancer survivors from around the world for a volunteer program for 2 weeks in India. Mornings are spent volunteering, and afternoons are spent learning the culture and touring about, including a cancer center in Delhi. I think it sounds kind of amazing.
Who are you?
I know. But, and this is key, the trip happens over my 50th birthday, so I kind of think it's perfect. This is my first big birthday since the whole cancer thing. And remember I said I wanted to do something spectacular, but something that wasn't all about me? Not a party or a weekend away. Celebrating with other cancer survivors, doing hands-on volunteer work, and seeing one of the wonders of the world in a country I consider both frightening and fascinating, that seems to fit the bill.
It does.
He was quiet for a short moment.
I'm kind of amazed, but it might be a great idea. Certainly an experience. How much does it cost?
Well, that's being worked out. It's a non-profit and gets some grants that underwrite part of the trip, but we're also supposed to raise funds. It's like a crowdsourcing thing. I was thinking that if I get selected, I'd just tell friends and family if they want to know what to get me for my birthday, they can pitch in there.
Not a bad idea. Definitely a once-in-a-lifetime trip. I think you should do it.
One of the many things I love about Chris is that he can respond like that. Just a supportive, you should do it, without days of angst and agonizing or picking the idea apart.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.